I love Shrek 2. If ever I were asked to describe the perfect sequel, a film that not only sustains the phosphorescence of its predecessor, but one that takes hold of its brilliance and momentum, and making use of every frame that precedes it as a trebuchet with its counterweight, propels itself far, far above its anterior peaks, traversing more grandiose summits and more daunting valleys than its forebearer ever could, I would say to look no further than Shrek 2 without skipping a beat. Following through in its precursor's rebellious but loving swings at the fairy tales of our past, it is a film that both reaffirms its audience that a happily ever after can be attained by anyone, no matter their eminence or elegance, and retaliates against the notion that happily ever after means an ever after without unhappiness. Its penetrating focus on the clumsy and at times antagonizing growing pains of someone who is convinced that they are undesirable and unlovable, transitioning out of their solitude and into the warm embrace of another, offers a more gripping story of betrayals, defeats, comedy noises, and musical numbers than saving a princess from a castle ever could. Rather than simply playing off of the mountainous range of kingdoms and the many romances lived out within them that have been weaved into place by the giants of storytelling's past, ones with names like Anderson, Perrault, de Villeneuve, Lang, and Grimm, Andrew Adamson and his co-writers offer an exuberant and climactic exploration of a quip that is as old as the fairy tales that the Shrek films so routinely reference. What happens next? Shrek's predicated paranoia of the classism and other prejudices he'll have to face at the hands of Fiona's family and kingdom, largely inspired by Stanley Kramer's Guess Who's Coming to Dinner, give rise to a streak of selfish and one-sided decision-making as his knee-jerk reactions clash against King Harold's insecurity, projected from atop the ramparts of insulation and condescension that half a lifetime of opulence has slowly built around him. And although this series of misapprehensions and emotional missteps leads to Shrek trying to become human, this vulnerability to error and the sincere willingness to grow from it that permeates through every character of the film succeeds in allowing not just its protagonist, but its entire cast to become remarkably, truly human. With its boundlessly more charming antagonist, its infinitely more bombastic comedic crashes, its exceedingly more grand in scale and rich in detail sets, as well as its bordering on being a book musical soundtrack, accompanying every beat in its story, filling it with more life and thematic presence than its predecessor and both of its successors combined, Shrek 2 not only outsteps and outpaces the film it was made as a sequel to, but it sets a benchmark for what a truly great sequel can be. With every presupposed preference projected onto another, and each emotional misunderstanding between its cast, it both galvanizes and reiterates its answer to what might be the most asked question in storytelling history. What happens next is growth, or at least the opportunity for it. It was Stanley Kubrick who once said of the myth of Icarus, "Forget the wax and feathers and do a better job on the wings." And that is exactly what Shrek 2 does. It defies expectations and reaches higher peaks than any other DreamWorks film I've seen because of it. It's magic, and I love it. Thanks, Andrew. Hey, thanks for watching. Big thank you to my patrons for making this video possible, especially these guys, and a very special thank you to Brian Phillips, Jan Seiberg, Shane Vino, Johannes Rosendahl, Long Hoon, Tristan Marino, Ib Scher, Ho, Brand Muffin, Justin Ziegler, Charles J. Boyle, Dr. Chike, Alexander Montgomery, and Deniane. Let me know what you thought about what I thought down below, and make sure to subscribe. Love you, have a good night.